Everybody awake? You with me this morning? As most of you probably know, Pastor Drake has gone this week to a teen camp up in the mountains. He left this morning about 9 o'clock, took rain with him, as a matter of fact. And he'll be gone. He'll be back Saturday, I think, or something like that. But you have me here the next 2 weeks, today and next week. So have some exciting things to talk to you about. So, as always, you know, Drake likes to start off with that spirit of, what does he call it? The spirit of delight. Thank you. Yeah. And that's a, so, you know, I'll start off with the same thing. I have a little story. There was a kindergarten teacher. By the way, we have a teacher, so you'll understand what I'm talking about here. A kindergarten teacher who gave her class a show and tell assignment. And she wanted them to bring in something that represented their religion. So the day came for them to bring in the things, and the first child got up and said, "My name is Benjamin, and I'm Jewish, and this is the Star of David." And the teacher said, "Very good, that's a good representation. Thank you, Benjamin, that's very nice." Second child got up and she said, "Hi, my name is Mary, and I'm a Catholic, and this is a crucifix." And again, the teacher said, "Outstanding. Very good. That's a great representation of your religion." The third child got up and he said, "Hi, my name is Tommy, and I'm a Baptist, and this is a casserole." We don't do anything if we don't eat, right? So anyway, why are we here today? Why are we here not only today, why are we here on this earth? That's kind of a big question to start off with this morning. Why? That's one that we all ask at some point in time. Why am I here? Well, this morning I hope to answer that question for you. Why are we here? What is our purpose here on this earth? What is your purpose here on this earth? Question is, are you able to answer that question quickly and easily? If not, that's what I'm here to help you with today. Today we're going to look at Matthew chapter 28. We're going to look at verses 16 through 20. If you're using Bibles that are provided in the church here, the small print ones, it's on page 989. The large print, it's on 1,550. We'll give you a moment to turn on your electronic device if you have your Bible on your smartphone or an iPad or something like that. And in the meantime, I want to take just a moment and address our Facebook Live audience this morning. We thank you for being here this morning, too. Levering technology, as Pastor Drake says, in order to be with us, even though you're not here physically, but to be with us in spirit and to join with us in this time of worship. So we appreciate that very much. Be sure you hit that like and share button on there so that others can see it too. All right, so let's read Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. We're getting there. There we go. All right, here we go. "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said," and please pay attention to this, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Let's pray quickly. Father, thank you for your word, your Bible that you've given us, your love letter to us, to tell us what you desire us to know. And I pray, God, that we would open up our hearts, our souls, our minds, our spirits to your Holy Spirit this morning and truly hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen. So this passage is what's known as the Great Commission. Jesus Christ commissioning his followers, in this particular case, the disciples, but all of us, to follow his commands, commissioning us to go out into the world. So I want to look at that this morning. As believers in and crazy followers of Christ, and that's what we're to be, crazy followers. We're Crazy Love series, so we are crazy followers of Christ. We have very clear instructions from the Lord. This world is our mission field. Amen?
Amen.
That's why we're here. This world is our mission field. You see, we may live here in this world, but this world is not our home. Do you agree with me?
Amen.
It's just like a missionary to Chile, for example. They may live in Chile. They may work with the people in Chile, but that's not their home. However, they are there doing what they are supposed to do. It's the same thing with us. This morning I want to look at three things that strike me from this passage that we just read. And when we break it down, I think it becomes very clear what it means to be a crazy follower of Christ. So, as a good Baptist preacher, I always have 3 points. And they're alliterate. Not illiterate, but alliterate. They start with the same letters. I'm illiterate, they're alliterate. Okay, so, let's look at them. The first one is, the directive is plain. The directive is plain. John, what do you mean by that? Well, let me tell you, I'm glad you asked. Appreciate that very much. The text is very clear. Jesus says to do what?
Go.
Go. So let's look at the definition of go. What does that mean? Well, the definition in the Bible says, or in the dictionary says, to move or proceed. Especially to or from something. To leave a place, to depart, and then catch this. To keep or be in motion, function or perform as required. Go, Jesus says. So as crazy followers of Christ, pretty simple, we are to go. Okay, we got that, right? To go? Everybody good on that? Go and do what? Go and make disciples. You know it. Hey, great. I may not have to preach here this morning. That's good. I like that. Make disciples. All right, so let's look at that part. What is a disciple? Well, again, we go to the dictionary, and the dictionary says a disciple is any follower of Christ. A person who is a pupil or an adherent of the doctrines of another, a follower, in this particular case, a crazy follower of Jesus Christ. So we are to go, and we are to tell people about Jesus Christ and his love for them. And make disciples. We go and we introduce them to Jesus Christ. We say, let me tell you about this guy. And here's why I put my full faith and trust in him. And I invite you to do the same thing and become a crazy follower, a disciple of Jesus Christ. Okay, so we know in the directive, it's plain. It tells us to go, and it tells us to make disciples. Sorry, Aaron, I'm wandering all over the place, so you're just going to have to follow me. I may end up over there somewhere. You never know. All right, so we are to go, and we are to make disciples. Then what? Anybody? Bueller? Go and make disciples, and then what?
Baptize
them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the triune God. Triune, what does that mean? It means three in one. Three distinct personalities in one person. And by person, I don't mean a human being, I mean God. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. One God in three distinct persons or roles. No one of them is more important than the others. No one of them is less important than the others. They are all one. So do you have a headache yet? You're going, whoa, wait, what? Go, make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Are you with me so far?
Yes.
You believe what I'm saying?
Yes.
Well, let's go then. Let's just go right now, should we? We'll load up, we'll go ahead down and find people walking around and just accost them. No, we won't do that. All right, so we get them baptized. So that means we're all done now, right? We went, we made disciples, we got them baptized, so now we're done. You guys are shaking your heads no.
No.
It means you must think that there's something else that needs to happen. What's next in the menu? Anybody? Teach. Yeah, teach. Go and make disciples and get them baptized and then teach them to obey everything Jesus says, I have commanded you. I want you to, and most of you have heard me say this in the Monday night Bible study and such, think of it like having a baby. When you have a newborn baby, that baby basically can do nothing for themselves, correct? All they do is eat, sleep, and poop. That's it. That's it. So when a person becomes a new follower of Jesus Christ, they are born again. They are reborn in the Spirit. They are a brand new baby. Now, just like you wouldn't just leave your infant to fend for him or herself, we don't leave a brand new Christian to fend for him or herself. Because guess what? If you do that, Satan's going to snap them up. Jesus says, teach them. Teach them what? To obey everything I have commanded you. How do we know what Jesus has commanded us? Well, we have this book called the Bible, if you've ever heard of that. And it has all of Jesus' commands in it. So that means let's get them involved in the Bible. Let's get them into small groups. Let's get them around other Christians. Let's get them involved in things so they understand that they have a family that they can rely on and be a part of here at FBC Church. So go, make disciples, baptize them, teach them everything I have commanded you. So would you agree with me, point number one, that the directive is plain, what we are to do? He doesn't shroud it in mystery at all. He makes it very plain what we are to do. The text is very clear about it. Now, second point under, we're not changing to point number two yet. This is the second sub-point under point number one, in case you're keeping an outline. And if you are, I am so sorry. You're going to be lost by the time we're done here today. I can guarantee it. So the second sub-point is, a task has been committed. What do I mean by that? Well, we are not only told what to do, we are told where to go. Where are we to go? Where does it say where to go and make disciples? Into all the world. That includes Fort Morgan, Colorado. That includes Morgan County. That includes your family. That includes your workplace. That includes your circle of friends. You see, we are to go into all the world, not just some random country overseas. Yes, we are to do that too. But it starts right here at home. It starts the second you walk outside those doors today.
Amen.
Thank you, Richard. I appreciate that. It's nice to know somebody's awake. When you walk outside those doors, you have just hit the mission field. Do you understand that? Is everybody with me on that?
Amen.
Okay? So you should always, always, what's that word?
Always.
Always be looking for opportunities to share Jesus Christ with others. Always. We're to teach the scripture. We're to train up for service those who believe in Jesus Christ. It's very plain, it's very clear, and I don't think I can beat that dead horse anymore. So we're going to move on. Point number two. There we go. The duty is personal. The directive was plain. Now, we're going to bring it closer. The duty is personal. You see, when Jesus says, go and make disciples, yes, he was talking to the apostles. He was talking to those that were physically with him. But do you realize he was also talking to you? Specifically, personally, to each one of you? And to me? Now, we can make excuses. Boy, we're pretty good at making excuses, aren't we? Yeah, there's always a reason. really do that because I'm just kind of inadequate. I don't really know the Bible, and I don't know what to say. And, you know, you're a pastor. You're much better at that. You should just go do it. That's an excuse, feeling inadequate. Jesus doesn't say, if you feel like it, you can go ahead and go and make disciples. No, he says, go! Make disciples! Go! It's a directive. It's not a request. It's a directive. Those of you who've been in the military understand, when a commanding officer gives you an order, he's not asking you if you want to do that. He's telling you, you will do that. Right, David? Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Jesus says, go. He doesn't say, if you feel okay about it, go ahead and go. You may feel inadequate. You may feel incompetent. Well, I've never been to Bible school, so I don't really. You know what? I'm standing up here preaching to you. Can I tell you a secret? I've never been to Bible school. How can you call yourself pastor? Because it isn't a Bible school that makes me a pastor. It's God through His Holy Spirit in me telling me, this is what I want you to do that makes me a pastor. And just like He tells me, I want you to be a pastor, He tells all of us, I want you to go. And you will go. Amen?
Amen.
Stay with me here today. I don't want to lose you, okay? I know it's coming across kind of harsh and rough, but you know, sometimes we need that, right? Parents, you understand that with your kids. Sometimes you got to get a little harsh with them to get their attention. Right, so I'm getting a little harsh today. You may feel inadequate. You may feel incompetent. You may feel inferior. I don't care. I really don't. You know, excuses, you've all heard this. Excuses are like armpits. Everybody has a couple and they all stink. If you come to me with an excuse, I'm going to call you out on it. Just like if I come to you with an excuse, I want you to call me out on it. John, you're making an excuse. You're right. I'm sorry. Let me just say this. You can make all the excuses you want, but you're never going to escape this. You see, when it comes to God, it's useless to try to run. It doesn't matter where you try to run to. God is there. It doesn't matter. It's useless to resist Him. How many of you are fans of Star Trek? Especially the Next Generation. Remember the Borg? What was their tagline? Resistance is futile. Well, same thing here. Resistance is futile, people. All you're going to do is frustrate yourself. Yeah, Carrie's over here going, I don't know what you're talking about. Is that in what book of the Bible is that in? Book of Borg. You see, this is the reason we were put here, to fulfill this calling, the Great Commission. Our calling, your calling, go and make disciples, baptize them, teach them, train them up. You'll never feel truly fulfilled, if you're trying to run from the will of God. Amen?
Amen.
The duty is truly personal. Let's go on to point number 3. Yeah, just like that. The dynamic is provided. This is where he says, and surely I am with you always. You see, when you're out there talking to people, you're not by yourself. Jesus is right there with you. The Holy Spirit will lead you if you'll let Him. He'll give you the words to say. He'll give you the attitudes. So it's not about you. Your inadequacies, your inferiorities. Some big words coming out of my mouth. It's not about those things. It's not about you. It's about Jesus Christ and His love for people who are lost. Do you realize you were once lost? And Jesus loved you so much that He brought somebody into your life to tell you about it. Thank God they did, right? Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. The assurance you have, He says, He will be there to provide for you. You have assurance in that. He will be there to protect you. There will be those people as you're out there doing what God tells us to do, the Great Commission, there will be people who will not be so happy about it. He's there to protect you. So that's the assurance you have. Now, we also must yield authority. The authority you must yield. We need to start by recognizing the lordship of Jesus Christ. He says in this passage we read, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Not me, Jesus Christ. That's him speaking. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus Christ. And he is transferring that authority to you. Go and make disciples. Any of you feel like you're getting beat over the head this morning? Every time I've read through this, and as I was preparing this message, it was just hitting me right upside the head like a mule kick. And it still is. And I hope and pray that all of you are feeling that mule kick this morning. The Holy Spirit is just smacking you upside the head and saying, listen, I'm talking to you right now. Jesus has the authority. He has the authority to commission you, just like I talked about with the military. Your commanding officer in the military has the authority to commission you for a task. This is the same thing. Jesus Christ has the authority to commission you. He has the ability to control. We need to go to him and say, Jesus, what do you want me to do? I'm under your control. And we have to respond to his lordship, the lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, this is not a suggestion. Again, Jesus does not say, hey, if you feel like it, if it's a good day, if you're not too tired, you know, and if it's convenient, maybe go and talk to somebody about me. He says, go. Real simple. One word. Go. Two letters. Go. Go. Anybody not understand what that word means? Go. Do you understand that that's not only a command, but it's also a time frame? The part of that he doesn't say but is there very clearly is now. Go now. Not next week, not next year, not sometime maybe after I'm retired and I have more time. No, go now. Go, go. Right outside these doors, there's lost people. Go. Go tell them about me. You're going to go to the grocery store, get some groceries, and there's somebody there that's just having a horrible day, and you stop and you say, hey, I can see that you're not having a great day. Can I pray for you? Well, you don't know me. I know. But I'd like to pray for you if I could. You see, you're making that connection. Go. Make disciples. We can't make disciples unless we go. And we have to talk to people. You see, this is a direct command to go on mission. The Great Commission. Do you understand that this is really the only mission in your life that really matters? It's why we're here, people. We are missionaries on this earth. This is not our home. Our home is in heaven with God. He has us on mission here on this earth. We need to fulfill that mission.
Amen.
I want to finish with a little story here. Some of you have heard this. I think I told it in the Monday night Bible study a while back, but that's where I test out all my material. anybody know who Penn and Teller are? The magicians? Yeah, Penn and Teller. All right, so they've worked in Las Vegas for years. They have a TV show and all that kind of stuff. Well, Penn Jillette, if you know the two, he's the tall one that does all the talking. Penn Jillette is an avowed atheist. So keep that in mind. He recorded a video journal a few years back telling the story about a man who wanted to speak to him after one of their shows. I'm going to move this down a bit because it keeps popping. This guy came up to him, and Penn said the man was obviously a very successful businessman. He was, to put it in Penn's words, quote, very sane and sincere. That's how he presented himself. And Penn said the guy looked him right in the eyes as he talked to him. The man was very complimentary of the show, and then he did a strange thing. He gave Penn a Gideon's New Testament Bible. And in that Bible, he wrote a personal note, and he left phone numbers and an email address if Penn ever wanted to get a hold of him to ask questions. Penn said nobody had ever done that to him before. And think about how many tens of thousands of people had come up and shaken Penn Jillette's hand after a show. This was the first person that ever did this or anything like it. Well, on the video, Penn Jillette says, and this is a quote, "If you believe that there's a heaven and a hell, and that people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life or whatever, and you think it's not really worth telling them this because it would make it socially awkward, how much do you have to hate somebody to not tell them? How much do you have to hate someone to believe that everlasting life is possible and not tell him or her that?" This is coming from an atheist. I continue on. He says, "I mean, if I believed without a shadow of a doubt that a truck was coming at you and you didn't believe it, and that truck was bearing down on you, there's a certain point where I just tackle you and get you out of the way. And this is way more important than that." This is an atheist saying this. A confirmed atheist telling us that if we believe in heaven, and we believe that hell exists, and we believe that there is eternal life, we don't tell people about it, we hate them. Ouch. I hope that hurts. I really do. I hope that hurts right here. The great commandment that Jesus gave us was to love God with all your being, everything, heart, soul, mind, strength, spirit, everything you have. And to love your neighbor as what?
Yourself.
As yourself. That's the great commandment. If you truly believe and obey the great commandment, then you'll be a crazy follower of Christ. And you will do everything you can to fulfill the great commission. Go, make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then teach them to obey everything I have taught you. Four things. Pretty simple. If you believe that, but you don't do it, you hate people. And you're maybe condemning them to an eternity in hell. Yeah, I know, it's pretty strong words, but I think we need that. I know I do. Let's close in prayer this morning. Father, I pray that the conviction that you have put on my heart this morning and through the preparation of this message, I pray that that conviction is being felt by every person in this room, every person watching on Facebook, that we would truly understand our role here, our purpose here, why you have put us here, why you have called us to yourself. It's not just to feel good about, oh, I'm going to heaven. It's not just about getting together as a social club in church once a week and playing church. It's about reaching the lost world in your name. That's why we're here. That is true worship, to do what you have commanded us to do. How can we say that we worship you if we don't follow your commands, if we disobey? So, Father, I just ask that you would put that conviction in each one of our hearts this morning, that we would feel that need, that desire so deeply that we couldn't help ourselves. that we would understand as we hit that door, we're in the mission field. And we're looking for every opportunity possible to introduce people to you. Our good, good Father. I thank you so much for this time together. And I pray, God, that this time would be a blessing to us all throughout the week. And that we would ingrain this message and make it very real. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.